our GLP-1 symposium, and that is Dr. Ghosh. He is a very learned personality, and he has his DM endocrinology and FRCP from London, Glasgow, and Edinburgh. He has a specialty certificate endocrinology and diabetes in the UK. He also is a professor of endocrinology at IPGMER, Kolkata, and he has been the person behind many of the editorial work. He's an editor-in-chief in the Oxford Handbook series, and we would directly go to his talk, that is an GLP-1 from concept to pill. Over to you, Dr. Ghosh.
Thank you, respected chairperson, sir. And thanks to Dr. Bansi as well for having given me this opportunity to present before such a learned August gathering. Now, being the last speaker of a talk can be useful and can actually be also very daunting, because you know a lot of what I was supposed to speak on has already been covered, which is useful in a way. So I have been asked to speak on the journey of GLP-1 RAs from the concept to an injection to now what we think is going to be available as an oral agent. Now, a lot of the bits of the initial slides would be repetitive, through which I would quickly go through so that I can probably spend more time on the oral agent rather than the injectable agents. So we've come a long way as far as the history of the incretin system is concerned, which I'm not going to bore you with. And this is the Gila monster from which the idea and the concept of exendin 4 came into being. And as you can see, a lot of work has actually gone in for the discovery of GLP-1 in the first place. And a lot of work has gone on in terms of the GLP-1 receptor agonists and the GLP-1 exendin-based derivatives, which have been used in clinical practice already for almost a decade now. We are all aware of how these group of drugs work. And I think both the speakers showed this slide, particularly Dr. Nandita showed us, you know, the possible physiological effects of GLP-1 and its benefits. The GLP-1 receptors agonists have actually been classified as exendin 4 derivatives and the GLP-1 analogs. Now, possibly in the near future, we will probably be using only the GLP-1 analogs and not the exendin 4 derivatives because of reasons that I will discuss a little later. And this is exenatide, which was found from the Gila monster. It is very similar to what the human GLP-1 is. That's followed by the lixisenatide, which got launched first, followed by liraglutide, which we've been using in India for quite some time. And this is something which is, you know, a GLP-1 analog similar, and it's not an exendin derivative. That's followed by albiglutide, which is not available in India. GSK has actually withdrawn albiglutide. And then dulaglutide, something which we've been using in India. Remember, dulaglutide is a much, much bigger molecule compared to all of the other GLP-1 analogs that we are currently using. So you can even think of classifying the GLP-1s in a different way, the smaller ones versus the larger ones. So in terms of, if you look at liraglutide, it's a much smaller molecule compared to dulaglutide, which is a large, much larger molecule. One of the reasons that I'm making this point is because I could see one of the audience asking a question about differences in weight loss of liraglutide versus dulaglutide. You've got to remember, the bigger the molecule, more difficulty it'll have in crossing the blood-brain barrier. And one of the things that the GLP-1 does is suppressing appetite. So the bigger molecules are less likely to be appetite suppressants and less likely to cause weight loss, unlike the smaller molecules, which will probably cross the blood-brain barrier much easily and cause more weight loss. So if you're looking at the smaller molecules, you expect more weight loss. If you're looking at the more larger molecules, you expect less weight loss. And again, you can again classify them depending upon how long they work. Are these shorter acting drugs or are these longer acting drugs? The longer the acting the GLP-1 analogs are, they are going to cause better fasting glucose reduction. And the shorter acting ones are going to have better effects in terms of postprandial blood glucose levels, because they are going to cause better gastric slowing and better gastric emptying. So if you reduce gastric emptying, the offset side effect is that you're more likely to have GI intolerance. So the shorter drugs will probably not have that much of an effect on fasting sugar. They'll have a better effect on postprandial glucose lowering, but at the cost of more GI side effects. The longer acting drugs will have less of GI side effects, less of postprandial glucose lowering, but better fasting glucose lowering. So with that, I've already summarized, you know, if you look at the fasting control, the postprandial control, and of course the longer acting drugs, you can be given once daily or even once weekly. And the longer acting drugs, because they do not have that much of a fasting glucose lowering, would be good to be used in combination with a basal insulin, which will help lowering the fasting blood glucose levels. And similarly, I've talked about the side effect, what would be the difference in the shorter versus the longer acting drugs. Now, if you look at the GLP-1 receptor agonists, if you're trying to compare one drug with others, you have a few clinical trials in place, and of which the AWARD-6 is one where you can actually look at and see that liraglutide will cause better weight loss compared to dulaglutide. The LEAD-6 compares liraglutide with exenatide twice daily. The duration compares liraglutide versus exenatide once weekly. And the Harmony, which is probably less relevant in our country because we do not have albiglutide. And you have several other studies in terms of head-to-head comparisons, which I'm not going to go jump into. And one of the things that Dr. Nandita, as well as Dr. Vinayak Sinha clearly showed, that all of the drugs are pretty good when it comes to HbA1c reduction, pretty robust reduction of HbA1c, very little to choose actually between the drugs, though there are individual variations. And if you look at the weight changes, I was talking about AWARD-6, you can see that liraglutide has greater weight reduction than dulaglutide. That's one of the questions that someone in the audience has actually asked. And again, all of them causing weight reduction. And if you look at, in terms of the side effects, I've already told you that probably the longer the acting drugs, the lesser the side effects are going to be in terms of the GI side effects. And the first speaker, Dr. Nandita, beautifully spoke about the CV outcome trials. I'm not going to bore you with all of that data. She's actually shown all of that. 7 major CV outcome trials, huge amount of data that we have. And what's important is none of the Exendin 4 analogs actually showed superiority results, whereas most of the GLP-1 receptor agonists showed benefit. And what's important is that the two studies that I think are important, which she highlighted, was one was the LEADER trial, which showed benefit. But on a personal front, I think I'm even more excited about the REWIND trial, because it had a huge number of primary prevention cohort group, essentially telling us that probably this group of drugs are probably the only group of anti-hyperglycemic agents which truly modify atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. We all talk about SGLT2 inhibitors, and like Dr. Nandita said, that they probably make changes to hemodynamics and not necessarily to atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease. So if you look at, you know, the protective effects, you can see exenatide LAR, the liraglutide and the dulaglutide are probably the ones that I would go with. I'll skip some of these slides because of paucity of time, but if you got to conclude, I've said the GLP-1 receptor analogs reduce the 3-point MACE, whereas the Exendin 4 derivatives don't. So moving on to the second half of my talk, you know, we are all talking about these GLP-1 analogs. Remember, all of the guidelines that talk about GLP-1 analogs are talking about injectable GLP-1s. So the data that we have for the oral GLP-1 as of now is still not that robust as with the injectable GLP-1s. But why are we so excited? Because, you know, everybody prefers to pop in a pill rather than take injections. It's going to be a complete game changer when we have oral GLP-1 available. Now, the fact that why is it so difficult to have peptides to be taken orally? Because we know the acid pH of the stomach and the proteolytic enzymes actually destroy peptides, and there is limited permeability of these peptides across the gastrointestinal epithelium. Therefore, the bioavailability is pretty low. But now we have the oral semaglutide, which is being tagged together with an absorption enhancer, the snack, about which I'll talk, which actually makes this really, really wonderful. It's got specific high affinity for albumin, which ensures that the drug's half-life is long. It is DPP-4 stable, therefore it will work for a long period of time. The molecular size makes it useful for prevention of biodegradation. The oral bioavailability is only about 1%. It is hydrophilicity. It is human GLP-1 based drug, and we can use in 2 different clinical doses of it. Now, we've already talked about that, you know, something orally once daily, giving the benefits of GLP-1 analogs would be something that we as clinicians are looking for. And what the scientists have done is they have tagged this drug with SNAC, which is sodium N8-2-hydroxybenzoyl aminocaprolate, which actually helps the absorption of semaglutide in this co-formulation that is given. And I'll show you a graphic of that. In this one tablet, you have the semaglutide along with the snack. Once you've ingested the tablet, it goes to the stomach, where the semaglutide and the snack comes out. The snack essentially lowers the gastric pH, prevents the damage to semaglutide by the acid pH, allows entry of the semaglutide in the epithelium, which then gets absorbed. Now, there are certain factors which can actually jeopardize this whole system. If you take food before this drug, that will reduce the absorption. And if you take too much of water or fluids along with this drug, that will reduce absorption. Or if you take food immediately after the tablet, that's going to reduce the absorption. And one of the worries is that will some other drug interfere with the absorption, or will some other drug's absorption jeopardize the absorption of this drug? One of the drugs where there is meaningful interaction is levothyroxine. So if you're giving that drug, space it out. And the instruction says, wake up in the morning in the fasting state with no more than half a glass of water, take the drug. And within half an hour of after taking the drug, do not take any other medicines or food, then take your meal and whatever other medicines that you need. In terms of the drug-drug interaction, I've already told you, pre-dose and 30 minutes after the drug, don't take anything, and don't take more than 120 ml of water. That's about half a cup of water. There's no significant co-administered drug interaction except perhaps levothyroxine. Oral semaglutide is also suitable for individuals who are on oral contraceptives. There is no clinically relevant differences in exposure of oral semaglutide, particularly because a lot of people take PPIs in the first thing in the morning, and no other safety concerns. And in spite of all of these precautions, only about 1% of the drug actually gets absorbed. But that's good enough. And if you look at the pioneer programs that includes all of these oral semaglutide studies, Pioneer 1 is against standard of care of diet and exercise. Pioneer 2 is versus SGLT2. Pioneer 3 is versus DPP-4. Pioneer 4 versus GLP-1 in an injectable form. Pioneer 7 is a flexible dose adjustment with DPP-4. Pioneer 8 with insulin. Pioneer 5 in individuals who have renal impairment. And Pioneer 6, which is a CV outcome trial. And if you look at all of these studies, what is clear is that the HbA1c reduction is robust and probably better than all of the comparators that we have used in all of these pioneer group of studies. So potency of A1c reduction, great. What about weight change? Because that's one of the selling points of GLP-1. Again, if you look at the weight reduction is robust with the oral semaglutide in the pioneer group of studies. And if you look at the cardiovascular outcome trial, the Pioneer 6, which was done predominantly to get the permissions for marketing, because there's another study going on to actually establish whether there is superiority benefit. This study which included almost 3,000 individuals, about 1,500 patients in each group. It included people over the age of 50 with cardiovascular disease or individuals above the age of 60 with cardiovascular risk factors. And if you look at the three-point MACE, it showed that it was non-inferior to placebo. Now, the rest of the data that we all talk about in terms of the cardiovascular death reduction, all-cause mortality benefit reduction, please remember that's exploratory. It looks very promising, just like the other GLP-1 injectable ones, but we'll wait for the bigger study to actually tell us whether this actually translates into statistically significant, clinically useful, meaningful benefits like some of the other GLP-1 receptor analog studies. So dramatic results in terms of all-cause death, but look at the numbers, very small, and it's more exploratory rather than something that you can jump into conclusions with. And so is the all-cause death. And that's summarized in this particular slide, which I will skip. And if you look at all subgroups seems to be doing equally well in the Pioneer 6 studies. And if you combine this Pioneer 6 with the Sustain 6 data, Sustain 6, remember, is the semaglutide injectables CV outcome trial, you can see that the results are pretty dramatic. So if you compare or summarize what you found in Pioneer 6, there's a 21% reduction in MACE, which is statistically non-inferior. There's almost a 50% reduction in cardiovascular death. This is exploratory. And there's almost a 50% reduction of all-cause mortality. Remember, again, the numbers are too small and exploratory. The A1C reduction and body weight reduction is dramatic, and the overall tolerability profile is consistent with other injectable GLP-1 analogs. So it's not surprising that when you're talking about at least the injectable GLP-1s, my two previous speakers have already talked about the impact that it's had in terms of determining where to use the group of drugs. I'm not going to bore you with that bit. We've already discussed all of this. And the point that Dr. Nandita quite clearly mentioned was that if you look at cardiovascular disease, it's best that you divide them into two groups. One, where there is high atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease load, and the other where you're more worried about heart failure. So if you're more worried about atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, choose a GLP-1 over an SGLT2 inhibitor. And of course you can combine, and therefore early intervention with the GLP-1 will probably be useful. And for the first time, I think we are all coming together to think of the patient in terms of the benefits of cardiovascular outcome. I shall stop there for any questions. Thank you very much.